April 1st, you will not see me on that one. Cost is $15. And again, you can see Andy Bingaman or Gabby Teeter for more information. It's for rock climbing. They got little pebbles for us, too. Because I ain't going up there. Huh? No, I ain't. That's still too big. Praise God. If you want some more information, you can see your bulletins, or you can also get online for more information. Any visitors? No visitors yet. Okay. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise, for you are the Holy One, the Mighty One. We thank you. We thank you for your presence. Father, you said that when we gather together and praise you, you are in our midst. So we want you in our midst. So we're going to praise you. We're going to glorify you. We're going to exalt you. But Father, we want to serve each other as well. Thank you. Thank you for your love and your mercy. I'm asking, Father, for all those that are traveling right now, coming this way to your house, Lord, that you bring them safely, Lord, Father. For those that cannot make it because they're out sick, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I claim healing over their bodies, Lord. We thank you, we praise you, and we glorify you. For you are a good, mighty, and a holy God and a loving Father. In the name of Jesus, amen. Okay. Sister Sharis.
I don't know how many of you were here last Sunday, but we had a glorious time with our water baptism. And those that are here, I would like to present your certificates. If you would come up, please. Jean Harold. Yes. You want to share just a little bit? Okay. Praise God. Brooklyn? Is Brooklyn here? God bless you. And we had a husband and a wife. I don't know. Can you come down? Are you able to come down? Chris? And Tim Strout. Chris and Tim are starting a new life in the Lord, and we just rejoice with them. I just can't say enough. I'm just really happy for them. Okay. Lord bless you both. Amen. Oh, you don't need this.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. It's good to have each and every one of you here today. I know it's a real frigid day out there, and I'm sure some felt like they couldn't come out in this weather, but you're here. And so I applaud you in my heart, and I just say, praise the Lord. We're going to pray over a man that is going to be the deacon over the building and the property. And I'm going to ask that Frankie Negron, if he would come and his wife would join him. I'm going to ask for the elders to come up and pastors, and we'll just pray right over Frankie today. Let me just tell you that Frankie really does so much work around here. I'm telling you, he is such a blessing to this church, and we just thank God for him. Amen. Will you stretch your hand in this direction as we just lift them before the Lord? Dear Father, right now for Frankie, we thank you, Lord, that he has stepped up. He's willing to be a deacon over the building and the property. And Father, already he's proved himself to be such a servant unto you. And so right now, Father, we just ask, as we pray for him, that he would be set apart to be a deacon here in this house. We ask that in the name of the Lord Jesus. Just anoint him for service, and we give you praise. Touch his wife, Margie. Lord, minister to her too as she supports him in this endeavor. We give you praise for her life, Lord, in Jesus' name. And we thank you for it. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We're going to celebrate Holy Communion this morning. I count it a privilege to observe this particular ordinance. I believe there's power in it. I really, really do. I think the tendency is this, because we celebrate it ever so often, that it becomes routine. But God doesn't want that to happen to you and me. Even though we have the elements involved, we have bread, we have grape juice, I'm here to tell you that there's a spiritual significance here, and we need to grab hold of that. The thing the Lord put on my heart was to read to you from Isaiah 53, verse 5, and note what it says. It says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him." How many can say amen to that? How many are glad for the blood of Jesus today? That precious blood has never lost its power. It cleanses you and me. Thank God for that. And it's also a weapon, hallelujah, against the powers of hell. And when we take the cup, we need to remind ourselves of that very thing. Today, all of us could experience a fresh cleansing by the blood of Jesus because of what he did in shedding his precious blood and dying for you and me. But the verse goes on to say, "And by his stripes we are healed." Peter, when he writes in his first epistle, chapter 2, verse 24, he doesn't say "are," he says "were." Isaiah prophetically is looking down through time, and he sees things that even the disciples didn't really understand as they stood around the cross. He foresaw that Jesus would pay the price, not only for our sins, but for the healing of our body. And he says prophetically, "By whose stripes we are healed." But now we got Peter looking backwards to the event. And he says, "Not our, but by his stripes we were healed." Today, as you partake of the bread, I want you to release your faith. The bread can be really an aid to your faith. You can release your faith right now. Think with me just for a moment. I preached a message one time, more recently on the stripes. And you know what? I had a lady that walked out. She wasn't upset with me or anything, but she says, "I just couldn't handle the agony that Jesus went through when he was scourged, when he was whipped." I tell you what, that only tells me one thing. God wants to heal us. Can you say amen? So when we partake of that bread, let's release our faith for healing. When we take of the cup, let's release our faith for a fresh cleansing for the glory of God. Amen. I'm going to ask you to come in a moment here, but let's just pray. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for your Son. We thank you for your eternal plan. Way back in eternity past, you foresaw, and I thank you that you sent your Son, and I thank you for that precious blood that really cleanses us from all sin. It is the answer to all guilt, and we thank you for that in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then, Father, I pray that as we partake of that cup, that you will just cleanse us afresh and anew. But when we partake of the bread, I'm asking in the name of Jesus that your healing virtue will go into each of our bodies, that you will impart healing and strength and health in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we give you praise and glory. Amen. All right, if you'll come, the people that are serving at this point, if they will avail themselves here. And once they're in place, then we will invite you, the congregation, to come down the middle aisle, if you would. And then you can egress down the outside aisle, but you don't have to go back to your seat. We have an altar here. We have the platform. Thank God. Listen up. You don't have to be a member of Brookside Ministries to partake in Holy Communion. You just need to be saved. It's an ordinance for a believer, so you need to know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Will you make your way down here and receive the elements in Jesus' name? Praise the Lord. Our sister is going to lead us in the Word. Amen. Please stand.
Morning, Brookside.
Morning.
I hope everybody signs up for the prayer and fasting. The Word relates to that with the Spirit. I just wanted to say that also the reason why I'm here doing the Word is because of the pray and fasting about 4 years ago. Combination of that and Denny Kramer's prophecy. So there's lots of good that come out of prayer and fasting, and there's a lot of power. So join me in Joel 2, 12 and 13. That is why the Lord says, turn to me now while there is time. Give me your hearts. Come with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Don't tear your clothing in our grief, but tear your hearts instead. Amen. Return to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry, and filled with unfailing love. He is eager to relent and not punish.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Together now, the gates of hell
Shall not prevail
against me.
The gates of hell
shall not prevail against Brookside. Hallelujah. Together now, dear Spirit of God, here I am. Help me to be open. Help me to be receptive. Touch my heart. Touch my life. Change me. In Jesus' name, we welcome you. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We welcome you. Let him have his way. Right, he's here. He's touching people right now. We have to open up. If we don't open up, we can be in his presence and experience nothing. So open your heart to the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Some of you are taken up with your problems and everything else. Just cast all your care on Jesus. Cast your care right now. Just throw it on him in Jesus' name. Amen.
Calvary with Jesus. you break when we walk into the room. Every heart starts burning, nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. We praise you, Lord. You're so good. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can you say praise the Lord? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Listen up. God has a word for us. So,
when Joshua brought the 12 tribes of Judah, they came to the Jordan. And many of you already know the story. It was a time of flooding. So the Jordan was overflowing. And the Lord told Joshua to put his foot in the water and that they would be able to walk over on dry ground. The Lord says today that my anointing is with you, but my anointing's going forward. My anointing is not in the past. The Lord says as soon as you put your foot out in obedience into the water Jordan, I will build up a wall of water. And how many of you know in the Bible it says 12 miles up is where the water started to stop and to pack up so that they could walk over. So they took the Ark of the Covenant, which means the Holy, and they began to walk over to the other side. For the Lord gave them a promise that they were going to the other side. But during that time, he also said, I want you to take a stone, every tribe of Judah, a memorial stone in that Jordan, pick it up and take it. And the Lord says today it was a memorial of what had been to the tribes of Judah. The Lord says they crossed over the Jordan because the anointing was going forward. The Lord says to the people of this church today, my anointing is going forward. The anointing for 10 minutes ago is not enough. It's old. The Lord says if you want to stay in the old anointing where there's nothing there but death, then cross back over the Jordan. But the Lord says today, my people, I have called you today, Brookside, to cross the Jordan in my anointing, for my anointing goes before you. The Lord says you're looking around at the circumstances and you're not seeing my anointing. The Lord says the things you thought 10 minutes ago, the mindset you had 10 minutes ago is now the past. The Lord says I'm not in the past. He gave you the memorial stone as a remembrance of what he did and what he brought you through. Not for you to stay there where there is no anointing. The Lord says, if you, my people, will be obedient and put your foot in the Jordan, I will make a way and you will cross over. The Lord says today, my anointing will be stronger than you've ever seen. For the Lord says today, my anointing is going forward. There's a climate change coming. It's here now and you need to walk in that anointing. It is going forward. The Lord says, keep your eyes focused on me. Don't look to the things that surround you. For the Bible says to set your face like flint. The Lord says, set your mind like flint. Look at me. Do not look to the right or to the left because it's destruction. You're going to see people aren't going to come with you this time. The Lord says you're going to have to leave them on the other side of the Jordan because it's their disobedience. Their disobedience that's keeping them there. It's their disobedience that has robbed them of the anointing. The Lord says they have been instructed just as you have been instructed. The Lord says, you go forward, you set your face like flint, and you follow my anointing and nothing else. And you will watch my power come like you've never seen it before. For the Lord says the climate is changing. And the Lord says my healing, my power, and my anointing are on the other side of the Jordan.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. What I feel in my heart this morning is that there's anointing in this house to heal. I believe that God would direct us in that direction at this very time. So I'm going to ask that the elders, pastors, and ministers in this place come up here because we want to anoint people with oil. I'm believing today that people will be healed. I'm believing that God's going to do something. And when I talk about healing, the Lord didn't tell me it was just physical healing. I believe he wants to heal some damaged emotions in people's hearts today. And you need to step out Don't be afraid of people around you. Don't be afraid of what they may think. Just be concerned about what God thinks. So if you need healing, I want you to step out right now. Will you come up and we're going to pray for you. We're going to believe God to do something awesome and powerful. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I know there's people here. God wouldn't put this on my heart unless there are people here that need some healing. Glory to God. We have the oil here. I notice we only got one bottle, so we're going to have to take some oil, use it, and pray. Hallelujah. We're going to believe God. It's down here. You got to get the oil. Praise the Lord. Symbol of the Holy Spirit. Release your faith. Release faith. Release faith. God wants to heal. He wants to heal. Hallelujah. We need some catchers up here too to be ready to catch anybody that would be going down. We need gentlemen, men, come on up here and get ready in case somebody would go down under the power. We got one down already, so.
when we were praying, God gave me a picture of souls, and the souls had holes in them, all kinds of holes. And then he showed me that there were snakes in these holes. And these holes, the snakes were the lies that we believe from the enemy. And God said to take the torch and then to put it in the holes to start the fire, because the snakes hate fire. Well, God, when he talked to me about the torch before, I asked him, okay, God, show me what is the torch? And he said, remember when I cut covenant with Abraham and we walked through the halves and the torch went in my place? He's talking about his covenant fire, that baptism of fire, let that burn those snakes out of those places. And grasp hold of what God says, because if you're saying anything and agreeing with your circumstances, you're agreeing and believing a lie, because God's word is the truth. If you're not seeing your truth, you confess it, and you are not confessing a lie, you are confessing a truth. And the enemy doesn't want you confessing that truth, because he knows what it's going to do, and he'll tell you you're a liar, because that's not going on in your life. But God's word is the truth. When you speak it out of your mouth, if he said it, it's the truth.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Just put it right there. Just put it down there. That would be good. Good. Praise the Lord. Thank God for his visitation, for the way he touched our hearts and lives today. How many can say, God really touched me in a special way? I mean, praise God. Hallelujah. I'll tell you, he's ready to do that every time as we open our hearts and lives to him. Well, I'm going to ask you to stand, and we're going to read one verse to get started this morning. And that verse is found in Matthew 17:21. Oh, someone called my attention to the offering. Boy, oh boy. Ushers, will you come? Now you know a little bit about me. I'm not in this for money, but the church needs help. That's where you could really give, because you're up, and you men can get to that billfold. And all right. Praise the Lord. Some prayer concerns to think about is Joel needs healing. He desperately needs healing. Joel, continue to pray for Betty. Let's ask God to heal her in a special way. Can you say amen? All right. One of you gentlemen grab this mic here and just lead us in prayer.
Precious Heavenly Father, we just give you all the glory and honor, Lord, for you. Thank you for who you are. We thank you for your sovereignty, Lord God. You know everything we bring before you, Lord, before we even present it to you, Lord. We just thank you for caring about us, Lord, for each hair on our heads, Lord God. We just thank you that you are concerned with every being here, Lord God. We thank you for what you're doing, Lord. Thank you for, again, who you are and your sovereignty, Lord Jesus. And we just want to give back now a small portion of what you've given us, Lord God. Use it for the furtherance of your kingdom, Lord, and just bless each and every giver here, Lord, in your holy precious name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. us, Lord. Amen. Thank you for your offering. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The passage scripture I'm just going to read at this moment is found in Matthew chapter 17, verse 21. These are the words of Jesus. He said, however, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. Let's ask God's blessing as we fellowship around the word. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we just ask that you have your way, that you touch our hearts, you touch our lives. Further, Father, through the word, through the ministry of the word, we just ask that in the name of the Lord Jesus. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. This Tuesday, we begin our 40 days of prayer and fasting. We want to encourage each and every one of you to participate. There's a sign-up sheet out there in the foyer. We have all the dates between now until April when we would conclude it, which would be April the 15th, which would be the day before Easter. So beginning next week, Tuesday the 7th, that's when we begin our 40 days of prayer and fasting. I just want you to know God's been doing a great work in our hearts and our lives. You know, the people that really are experts when it comes to church growth or church business, they tell us the first 100 days are the most important in any year. And what I've seen is that in January, we were really involved in prayer for two events that were going to take place in February. The two events would be the revival services. Thank God for the people that were saved, the people that were baptized in the Holy Spirit, for the people that were healed. I tell you, that's awesome. And then the other event that we, in January, were praying about was what happened the following weekend. And that was our marriage seminar. And God just began to work in a mighty way in marriages. And what I have seen, I just praise God every day because there's been such restoration. Amen? Later this month, we're going to be having a prophet here, Dennis Kramer. He is really used of God. He ministers in such an awesome and mighty way. And I know this, you're going to be excited once you get in the service if you've never been in a service with him. But this fasting is something that is part of this 100-day thing. And we just want you to participate because God wants to move in a special way. Let me give you a little background concerning this scripture. We find that Jesus is up on the Mount of Transfiguration. He's got the inner circle there, Peter, James, and John, and they see his glory and how he's transfigured below, or transfigured before them. But at the base of the mountain, there was something that was going on. There was a man who brought his son that was demonized, and sometimes because he was under the influence of a demon or demons, he would be cast into the water or into the fire. And guess what? They brought this son to the disciples that were down at the base, the other nine, and they could not bring deliverance to that young man, okay? They couldn't bring deliverance at all. And when Jesus came down with the other three, of course, he right away engaged and he cast out that which was demonical. And then he really reproved the disciples about their faith, okay? And guess what? He not only reproved them about their lack of faith, but also he said, sometimes these things don't come out except by prayer and fasting. I believe that God wants us to realize that whatever he's done already in this body of believers, so far this year, he wants to do more. And I believe that God wants to bring a new level of power in our midst. He wants to do that because he wants you and I to realize that he wants to fall upon us to refresh and renew us even in a greater measure than already he's done that. I believe that we need the power of God to fall upon us, to give us a passion, not only for souls, but listen, for holiness. God wants us to experience holiness in our lives. I believe we need the power of God to fall upon us to give us a real hunger for the Word of God. You know what they tell us? Only 13% in any given congregation of the people actually read the Bible every day. Wow.
God wants us to get into the Word. Can you say amen? And when it comes to worship, He wants to fall upon us with His power so that worship is more than just in the service time, but we have a lifestyle of worship because God wants us to have that kind of priority. He really does. And I believe He wants to fall upon us with His power so there be a new spirit of generosity, because He wants us to have that, by the way. And I believe this visit from God can only come as you and I press into God, not only with prayer, but also with fasting. Now, what does it mean to fast? Because we have some that have never fasted before. Look up here, if you will. Fasting is when a Christian abstains from food for spiritual purposes. We let go of the present in order to tap in to what is eternal, but what is spiritual, into that particular realm. That's what God wants us to understand. Did you know there are different fasts? There really are. Let me give them to you today. There's the normal fast, and that's what Jesus did for 40 days and 40 nights. And the Bible makes it very plain that afterward He was hungry. I want you to know it doesn't say afterward He was hungry and thirsty. In the normal fast, you still drink water because that cleanses your body of the toxins. And certainly, you couldn't go 40 days without water. But God wants us to see something that I think is so important. Some people think that Jesus just fasted to just be an example. I believe He fasted because He needed to fast. When you think about the eternal Son of God, and He came here to this earth, and this is described in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, that He emptied Himself. They call that in theology the kenosis. It's the self-emptying of the eternal Son of God. What did He not empty Himself of? He didn't empty Himself of His nature and of His attributes. He wasn't any less God on earth than He was in heaven before He came to earth. So what did He empty Himself of? He emptied Himself of the use of His divine attributes. He emptied Himself of that so He could utterly depend upon the Father and on the Holy Spirit to be an example to you and to me. I believe Jesus needed to fast just like we should fast. I believe that with all of my heart. And certainly He had faith. We know that, but He still needed to fast. And so guess what happened? He went up on there to fast, and God helped Him to overcome the devil. And we know the Bible makes it very plain that He came back from that and He began His ministry in a wonderful and powerful way. There's a partial fast, and that's the one mentioned in Daniel chapter 1, verse 12. That's when you abstain from certain foods. Now, you that are diabetic, I want you to know you can still fast in this regard. You're still going to need to eat, but you can cut out some things, and probably some of those things is things you shouldn't be eating anyway because you're a diabetic. But we can let go of those things. And I want you to know God honors that. So we limit our intake to certain kinds of foods. There's the absolute fast. This happened to none other than Paul himself. He was called Saul up to that point, but on the road to Damascus, he met the glorified Christ that outshone the noonday sun, and he fell to the earth. He was blind. They had to lead him into Damascus, and you know what happened? God used Ananias to help him out. He got healed. He got certainly baptized in the Spirit, and he got baptized in water, and that's awesome when you really think about it. But it tells us for 3 days he did not eat or drink, okay? That's an absolute fast. How about a private fast? Well, I believe that Jesus talked about that. He made it very plain in Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18, that we all should have our private fast, okay? But then there's the corporate fast. That's when a whole church decides they're going to get involved in a period of time with fasting and prayer. God wants us to realize that there are these different kinds, okay, of fasting. There's the national fast. In fact, you can read about this in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 3. And there King Jehoshaphat called all of Judah together to fast because they were being invaded by a coalition of armies. I want you to notice up here, if you will, please, because prayer with fasting is a powerful partnership with God. I want you to notice further, fasting is a kingdom of God weapon. How many heard that? Today, you know, when you fast, it releases something. It releases the power of God in your life as it does in mine. It brings about deliverances. It brings about healings. It brings about answers to prayer and victories over temptations. It really strengthens you and me in our spirit. And it does more than that. It really puts the soul and body under our human spirit that's indwelt by the Holy Spirit. I believe when we are involved in prayer and fasting, it is a very effective means of seeing things shaken for God. Hallelujah. Now, fasting and prayer really have a wonderful chemistry when you think about it. Okay? Because together they create a spiritual chemistry that releases a supernatural power in your life and in mine. Fasting also can bring to us, while we're involved with the prayer aspect and the fasting, a special word from God. Sometimes we need to hear God. Some people come to me as a pastor and they say, I can't hear God. You know what I want to tell them? And I do tell them, why don't you take some time just to pray and to fast? And as you wait on God and you let go of the temporal, hallelujah, you're going to grab hold of that in the spiritual realm. God's going to speak to you. He's going to give you a special word, and you'll be able to see God work in a mighty and powerful way. And you'll find yourself brought into new levels of Holy Spirit activity. That's what happens when we fast, by the way. And you know what? I believe fasting helps you, helps me to discover our gifts and to see the activation of those gifts in our lives. Fasting and prayer together creates something that I like. It creates what you would call a spiritual flow of that can really work on the hardness of our hearts. Every once in a while somebody says, you know, it seems like I'm really hard in my heart. I want to reach out to God, but nothing's getting through. Nothing's happening. Well, fasting and prayer, I believe, breaks through that hardness of a person's heart, and it removes the old dead wood, and really it ignites a new fire in the heart. You find, wow, praise God, I feel some real freedom that I haven't had for a while. And I believe when you fast and you pray, it can together release a new level of spiritual dedication. What I mean by that, by the way, is this. Fasting helps us to express, deepen, and confirm the decision that we are willing to sacrifice for God. We're willing to sacrifice everything. We're willing to sacrifice ourselves. We're willing to put ourselves on the altar and say, here I am, God. You take over in my heart. You take over in my life. Amen? And to you out there that are finding yourself having a hard time with bondages, I'm here to tell you that fasting and prayer will help you to break those bondages. To break the bondages of sinful habits, it will defeat the demonical power that's oppressing you. Hallelujah. It's going to give you new strength to be able to stand against sin and to stand against the devil. Another case of this bondage would be in the area of drug addiction. I'll tell you what. God, I used to work in Teen Challenge Ministry. When I saw people there with fast and pray, all of a sudden, man, God did something so miraculous inside of them. They got free of drugs. By the way, you parents, if you have a son or daughter that's involved in drugs, pray and fast for them. God will break over them. That power, He really will. And you'll see them come to the Lord. In fact, many times people have said to me, you know, it wasn't until I prayed and fasted that I saw my son and my daughter come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And that's amazing. It really is. Because something happened. You know, we can't always explain it, but something happens in the atmosphere. Something happens in the spiritual realm that does something to cause people. It doesn't mean God forces them because they have a free will. But it does something to get them to be open to God and what He's trying to say to them. Amen? And you know, some of us had real complex problems, okay? I'm here to tell you. Or maybe they're complex situations. I'm here to tell you that the Holy Spirit will help you to solve those by His solutions, not your own. It won't be your carnal mind thinking of a way out. It'll be God giving you strategy. It'll be God opening to you insights that you need in order that you can be free. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I also know this, that fasting and prayer allows the Holy Spirit to do something more, to conquer the mental and emotional problems that control our lives. Some of you out there need help that way. You really do. So you need to not only pray, but you need to fast. Amen? Now, you might start out just fasting a meal, but then you might end up fasting a whole day. As you get alone with God, I'm telling you, you're going to be strengthened in your spirit. You're going to be strengthened in your resolve. You're going to be strengthened in such a way that you will be able to overcome like you never have before. Amen? I believe prayer and fasting always sees results. And right away, you may want to argue with me about that, and that's okay. But remember, some results are visible and some are invisible. Sometimes you don't see what's happening in the invisible realm until much later, but God did do something through that. And that's why we need to be faithful that way. Amen? Now, I want you to notice just briefly this morning the dynamic benefits of prayer and fasting, okay? And the first one is positioned to receive direction from the Lord. One example is found in Acts chapter 13. Some people think it was the whole church that was gathered together, but it wasn't. It was the prophets and the teachers. And the Bible makes it very plain, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, guess what? The Holy Spirit said, "Now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." Then, having fasted and prayed, they laid hands on them and sent them away. I believe another benefit would be positioned to receive more of the power of the Spirit. I talked about Jesus. I'm going to talk about Him again. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. But He came back from the wilderness in the power of the Spirit. Luke chapter 4, verse 14. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of Him went out through all the surrounding region. So thank God, you and I can have more of God. How many believe you can have more? You know, we sometimes say, well, all I got to do is use what I got. However you want to describe it, okay? Whether you got it, but you just need to use it, or you need to have more of God, it doesn't matter to me. It just, let's see more of the power of God in your life. I want to see more of the power of God in my life. I go back again to Smith Wigglesworth, a man that raised people from the dead, and his prayer often was, "Lord, make my vessel bigger that I can hold more of You." I want to hold more of God. I don't know about you. I really, really do. Okay? And then the third thing is positioned to receive answers to prayer. Okay? This is what happens, I believe, so often. People say, "I've tried. I'm going to tell you the honest truth. I believe in faith. I believe sometimes all we got is formulas. We declare when we shouldn't be declaring because we still should be interceding because we haven't prayed through yet. I believe there's a place to declaration, to declaring and all that. We just got to be led by the Spirit. But there's a sensitivity that comes into your spirit and mind when we do fast and pray. We're able to hear God like we haven't heard Him. And that's what I believe God wants us to see. Really. Now, the fourth thing is positioned to see the hand of God move. I'm going to give you an example from Scripture. I really talked about this last week. It's found in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 2 and 4. What happened is this. Jehoshaphat, he says the following, okay? He says, "A great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea," okay?
Now, there was a coalition. There was all these armies coming against them. Remember how I told you last week? They certainly prayed further. And what was the strategy? Because I talked about strategy last week. They put the praise team ahead of the warriors, okay? That was pretty neat. But before that happened, let me finish this. It says, and Jehoshaphat feared, because he heard that news. And he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all of Judah. So Judah gathered together to ask help from the Lord and from all the cities of Judah. And they came to seek the Lord. God delivered them in a special way. This church has gone through some real difficult times. But I'm here to tell you, even as we heard today, God's got something special for us. I thank God for that service a while back, when it'd be 2 weeks ago, when the Spirit just came down in a mighty way. You want to know why God did that? Because He loves this church. He's for this church. This church, God has put strategically in this area, and He's going to use it even in a greater measure than ever. In all the time that's been in existence, God's going to use it in a greater way than ever before. Yeah. Hallelujah. But we need to pray. We need to fast. Can you say amen? Amen? All right. The fifth benefit here would be position for spiritual breakthrough. Some of us need that breakthrough, and I really have talked about that and really have woven that throughout this message. But you know, when spiritual breakthrough comes, it comes when we make a choice, when we, in our heart of hearts, desire to get out of the rut that's in our life with God's help and power. We have to desire that. We really do. He'll work in our hearts if we let Him to bring us to that point of decision, okay? And when you talk about breakthrough, it's an act of overcoming or penetrating an object of restriction. And in a spiritual sense, there may be some restriction in your life that has kept you bound. And you need a breakthrough. God wants to give you that breakthrough. Praise be to His name. And you say, breakthrough, what does that mean? Well, let me just enlarge upon that. What wasn't reality suddenly is. What hasn't worked suddenly does. The unwanted situation or object that was there suddenly isn't. That's breakthrough. It really is. The relationship that was unloving suddenly was loving. How many of you in the marriage seminar can say amen to that? Amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, man. Thank you, Jesus. The job that hasn't materialized suddenly did. That's breakthrough. Breakthrough in understanding a dilemma by seeking it from God. From seeing it from God's perspective and strategy. That's what God wants us to understand. Breakthrough in answers to problems. Breakthrough in ideas, insights, and new thoughts and strategy. Oh, praise God. He wants to do that for you today, for me. In a mighty way. The sixth one is positioned to receive amazing spiritual benefits. If you would read in chapter 58 before the verses I'm going to give you, we find that God talks about the real fast. A kind of fast that isn't self-centered, but a fast that brings about deliverances. It helps people. Okay? And then, after that we find Isaiah 58, verses 11 and 12, and it says this, because really, these are spiritual benefits. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall rise up in the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. Man, you see these spiritual benefits that come? You're talking about light. You're talking about health. You're talking about righteousness. You're talking about glory. You're talking about answered prayer. You're talking about continued guidance. You're talking about satisfaction. You're talking about refreshing. You're talking about work that endures. That is the work of the Lord that endures by His empowerment. You're talking about restoration. That's what God wants us to see. The final one I'm going to share with you this morning is when we talk about the benefits of fasting would be positioned to succeed in spiritual warfare. There's a passage from Isaiah that I think is really great. It's Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. Listen to it. But in that coming day, no weapon turned against you will succeed. It will not prosper. Amen? It doesn't mean a weapon won't come against you, but it's not going to succeed. It's not going to prosper. It goes on to say, you will silence every voice raised up to accuse you. Boy, I like that. These benefits are enjoyed by the servants of the Lord. Their vindication will come from me. I, the Lord, have spoken it. Boy, oh boy, what a benefit as we seek the face of God. Now, I believe we as a congregation need to move together. Out there, there's a sign-up sheet. Some of you say, well, I don't want to sign up because I don't want anybody to know I'm fasting. Okay, that's fine. But when you talk about a corporate fast, that's when a group decides to fast. So it's a little bit different. But if you still feel that way, that's okay. But there's also a sheet out there with some items to pray for. Because when it comes to intercessors, some need a list. There are intercessors that have to have a list. There are other intercessors that say, I don't need a list. I just pray whatever God gives me at the moment, okay? I don't think one's better than the other. We need to intercede. Can you say amen? Sometimes we do both. But please, sign up and let God work in your heart and your life. Will you stand in His presence right now? Hallelujah. Now, when we talk about fasting, most people don't get excited about that. It's self-denial. It really is. I don't want to fast. I tell you what, I'm hungry too. I think I'm hungry right now, okay? But I fasted this week. But I'm hungry. I get hungry like you do. But when you're fasting, when the hunger pangs come, that is a message to you to start praying. To start praying. Amen? I want to encourage you, if you've never fasted, try fasting a meal and see what it does for you. Hallelujah. How many out there need direction? Okay, how much do you really want it? Amen? It comes down to that. I had a brother told me, he said, I haven't heard God tell me anything for I don't know how many years. I don't know what He wants me to do. Boy, I'll tell you, He's speaking. God is. There's something wrong there. How many today need to see some loved ones touched, delivered, and set free? How many of you really? Amen. Okay, can I tell you something? We pray and pray, and I do believe. I believe in the God kind of faith. I can't manufacture that. Some people try to manufacture it. And it'll spring up within you, and it'll be there. And then, you praise God. Can you say amen? The Lord just spoke to me about, showed me a vision the other day. I won't go into it all, but it had to do with the crossing of the Red Sea. And the Lord was showing me how this was happening in a spiritual sense for this church. And I said, where's the rod? He says, hold the vision before me and praise me. And as you praise me, you're lifting up the vision that it becomes a rod then. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, God, I don't want to be wimpy, do you? I want to stand up in God. I want to be empowered by Him like never before. And that means we got to get out of self. We got to take up our cross daily and follow Him. And that may mean some fasting. Amen. How many today can say honestly, God has spoken to you about your need, not your neighbor's need, your need of coupling with prayers and fasting? How many could raise your hand up and hold it up there? Amen. Glory be to God. Oh, thank you, glory. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, my. God. The Lord's good. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, maybe you ought to come up and dedicate yourself to that. Now, that's going to take a little bit of gumption, maybe, to step out. Hallelujah. We had a young lady that felt God's call on her life. I encourage her today to get into some fasting and with her praying if she hasn't. God wants to work in a mighty and powerful way. Some of you are just stuck in a rut. Come on. Can you say amen? Okay, maybe there aren't so many because I didn't hear it very loud. But some of you are stuck in a rut, man. God wants you to get out of that rut. He really does. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Here comes sister up here that wants to get out of a rut. I know her well enough so I can say that. Praise the Lord. Are there others? I know we prayed around the altar, but here are some people that are dedicating their lives to this. And you that aren't up here, right out there in the foyer is a sign-up sheet, and there's a paper with some needs, okay? All right. Will you raise your hand and hold it up? Dear Heavenly Father, touch each one here. Oh, yeah, by your power, by your Spirit. In the name of Jesus, touch him mightily. In the name of Jesus, stir us, oh God, I pray. Help us to get out of our complacency. I come against that spirit that seems to rule this region and influence churches here. And that's a spirit of lethargy. I bind you up and I break your hold over this congregation. I break your hold over this valley in Jesus' name. Now, Father, may we go with purpose in our hearts. May we go in the name of Jesus. And may we determine that what we have gained so far in our own personal lives, in the lives of this church already this year, that we're not going to let it go. But we're going beyond that. Hallelujah. Because of the anointing that is released in this in the midst of the people of God here in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you. Oh, yeah, Lord. Look, more. More, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.